Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you for viewing the New Ransom Church of the Living God YouTube broadcast. We bring you greetings, and we welcome you to come and join us at any time when our doors are open. We have services on Sunday at 10 a.m., 11 a.m., and 5 p.m., and also on Tuesday and Wednesday nights at 7:30, we have Bible study and prayer. This morning, we're going to be in Acts chapter 10, verse 1. As we're going through this, if you got any questions, just raise your hand and we'll try and tackle your questions. Acts chapter 10, verse 1. Our subject this morning is, make sure you got it right. Amen? Make sure you got it right. Acts chapter 10, verse 1. Bible says, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band, a devout man, and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. Y'all see this man's resume? The short snippet of his resume. Verse 2, it says he was a devout man. He was devoted to divine worship and service. That's what devout means. He was devoted. And one that feared God with all his house. He feared God. He was devoted to worship. And which gave much alms to the people. He gave much money. He helped people out. Good man, right? And prayed to God when? Always.
Always.
Hallelujah. Sounds as if from this short snippet of Cornelius' life, it sounds as if he got it right. He sounds like a good Christian, right? A good Christ-like man. Thank you, Jesus. But he failed to gain something. We're going to keep reading and find out what that was. Thank you, Jesus. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming in to him and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And he said unto him, thy prayers and thine alms are come up for a memorial before God. Your prayers and your alms, the helps that you're doing, the money that you're giving, God said, I see it. Hallelujah. God see what you're doing. The Bible said, the eyes of the Lord is in every place, beholding the good and the evil. Hallelujah. God see his good works. He sees his prayers. Now you will really say, man, this man really got it together, right? He's not just doing good things. He's not just praying. He's not just a good man, but God is seeing his works. God said to come up as a memorial before me. He said, it's beautiful in my sight. It's a beautiful thing. Hallelujah. And in verse 5, he said, and now send me into Joppa. Now God giving Cornelius some commandments. He said, I want you to send some people to Joppa and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter. He said, I want you to send some people to Joppa and go get my preacher. Hallelujah. I need my preacher to come down because he got something to tell you. Hallelujah. He lodging with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the seaside. God has spoke to Cornelius and told him where Peter was at, who he was living with, and where he was living at. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You ain't got no privacy when you're dealing with God. God know exactly where you at, Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He said, go get him. He shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do. Peter gonna tell you what you ought to do. See, when you start dealing with God, God don't tell you what you better do. He tells you what you ought to do. He leaves it all on your plate. You ain't got to obey God. God ain't going to make you obey him. Hallelujah. He ain't going to make it. It's all up to you. But you need to understand the consequences for obeying God and the consequences for not obeying God. See, consequences ain't always bad. Okay? There are good consequences. Hallelujah. You serve God, you get life eternal. You don't serve, you get eternal damnation. You go to hell. Yeah? And here's Cornelius, a good man, praying to God all the time. Huh? Giving money to people, fearing God. He even taught his house to fear God. And he was a devout man, but was on his way to hell. Ain't that so? You better make sure you got it right. Huh? Make sure you got it right. Yeah, you can be a good praying man, a good praying woman. But you better make sure you get baptized in Jesus' name and get the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. It's good to fear God. It's good to pray to God. It's good to help people. Huh? But good people can go straight to hell. Saved people go to heaven. Huh? Thank you, Jesus. Keep doing your good deeds. Keep sending up those prayers to God. But you better make sure you get it right. Hallelujah. Make sure you get it right. There are some sinners in the world, some of the nicest people you ever meet in your life. Huh? Some of the nicest people you ever meet. Some of them will be sinners. Huh? Soft-spoken, sweet, good spirit. Huh? Don't partake in evil things. But they don't got the Holy Ghost. Okay? That's the key. You got to get the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is your ticket. The Holy Spirit is your ticket into the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Huh? So, Cornelius doing these good deeds, and God saw his good deeds. Look, if God see your heart is right in the sight of him, he ain't going to let you go to hell. He see your good heart. You know what he'll do? He'll have you cross paths with one of his Christian people, one of his holy preachers, huh? Who will tell you what you ought to do. And if you love God, you'll obey his word. Huh? Person who love God, they'll obey his word. They're not going to fight God's word. Because if you fight the word, you're fighting God. Because he is his word. But God see people heart. He know when you got a sweet, tender heart. He know whether your heart is right in his sight or not. And he saw Cornelius. He saw everything Cornelius was doing. He was praying. He was devoted to divine worship. He was doing good deeds, huh? And God said, this stuff has come up before me as a memorial. God said, I can't let this man go to hell. Let me give him the opportunity he needs. Hallelujah. See? And you got to look at this too. Cornelius was a Gentile. God had no dealings with the Gentiles or Samaritans. See? He only dealt with the Jews up until this point in Acts chapter 10. Huh? No Gentiles had got saved. The only people that got saved in the Bible up to chapter 10 was Jews. Huh? God looked on this Gentile. God said, look, it's time for me to open up the door to these Gentiles. These Jews won't hear me. These Jews are making themselves unworthy of this eternal salvation. Let me turn to a people for my name's sake. Huh? And God said, all the Gentiles shall praise my name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God see our hearts, y'all. Hallelujah. God don't look on the outward only, but he weighs the spirit of a man and a woman. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He likes your heart. Hallelujah. When it's right in his name Jesus. He's not going to let you. He's not going to let you. Hallelujah. Go to hell if your heart is right in the sight. Where is that? Thank you, Jesus. Somebody get that door. Thank you, Jesus. So God don't want nobody. The Bible said this in Peter chapter 3. Peter chapter 3, he said, it's not my will that any perish, but that all come to repentance. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 9, I believe. He says, not my will. See, it ain't God's will that any of us perish. Ain't that good news? Huh? Ain't that good gospel? Hallelujah. God don't want none of us to perish. He don't want none of us to die and be separated from him forever. He don't want that for us. He said, that is not my will for you. But my will for you is that you and everybody else come to repentance. Huh? When you start talking about getting right with God, you got to address sin. We just can't take sin and sweep it up under the rug and act like it ain't there. Trying to act like the house clean because we're going to hear everything in the closet. It's not clean. That's just tucked away. You're trying to hide it from the visual sight of God. When God sees you putting it in a closet, he sees you sweeping it under the rug and then acting like you got it all together. Hallelujah. You better make sure you sure enough got it right. The Bible said, make your calling and election sure. Hallelujah. Make sure you're sure about this thing. Huh? Gotta have a blessed assurance. Huh? Thank you, Jesus. So, he told him, send for my preacher. He got a message for you. He gonna tell you what you ought to do. How many know you ain't got to obey God? You can live your life however you want to. But you need to understand the consequences for living how you want to live. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And verse number 7. And when the angel which spake unto Cornelius was departed, when the angel left, he called two of his household servants and a devout soldier of them that waited on him continually. He had soldiers waiting on him for commandments. He took them. He told them. When he had declared all these things unto them, he sent them to Joppa. He obeyed the voice of God. Sent men down to where Peter was. On the morrow, as they went on their journey, he drew near unto the city. Peter went up upon the housetop to pray about the sixth hour. On the morrow, as they went on their journey, as Cornelius' servants and soldier went on their way, drew nigh unto the city, Peter went up upon the housetop to pray about the sixth hour. And he became very hungry and would have eaten. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance. God had to separate Peter from everybody else that was in the house so he could deal with him and let him know what was going on and who was coming to him. Hallelujah. So he went up to the top of the house and he began to pray. Bible said Peter was hungry. He would have ate, but the food wasn't ready. He would have ate, but it wasn't ready. He said while he was waiting, he fell into a trance. He had a dream, a vision. Hallelujah. And saw heaven opened. This is the vision. He saw heaven open and a certain vessel descending unto him. As it had been a great sheet knit at the four corners and let down to the earth, wherein were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth and wild beasts and creeping things and fowls of the air. So what he's saying, there's this sheet coming down from heaven down to the earth. This big old sheet, white sheet. And within the sheet are four-footed beasts and birds, wild beasts and creeping things. And all these things are things that God told the Jews not to eat. He told the Jews, he said, don't eat these things. So all of these forbidden meats are in this sheet that people are seeing descending down to heaven. Thank you, Jesus. And there came a voice to him, and it said, arise, Peter, kill and eat. So there's a voice talking to Peter in this vision, telling him to eat all these meats that God told them not to eat. Peter said, not so, Lord. Peter said, not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean. Peter said, I ain't never ate these animals, Lord. These are forbidden for us to eat. See? I ain't never ate them. And the Lord spake unto him again the second time and said, what God hath cleansed, that call not thou common. God said, what I have cleaned up, don't call it common or unclean. That's God showing. See, the vision is this. The four-footed beasts, the forbidden meats that God told them not to eat, those are the Gentile. That's the Gentile nation. Because God also told the Jews, don't take my word to the Gentiles, nor to the Samaritans. They was to keep it in Israel, amongst the Israelites. See? So you got a people, a nation of people that God said, don't go to them. Don't give them my precious word. And then you got meats that God said, you better not partake or eat these things. Yeah? So in the vision, us Gentiles were the wild beasts and the fowls that was forbidden. Yeah? And God telling him, go to them. Go to them now. Huh? Go to them. This is God showing Peter that he's opening up the door for the Gentiles to obtain salvation. Well, Peter don't know that yet. Peter don't understand what this vision is at the time. Hallelujah. So, let's keep reading. Verse 16, he said, this was done thrice. This happened three times. And the vessel was received up again into heaven. Now, while Peter doubted in himself what this vision which he had seen should mean, behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate. Now they have made it to Simon's house where Peter is. They standing at the gate, telling everybody, we here for Peter. Hallelujah. And called and asked whether Simon, which was surnamed Peter, were lodged there. Hey, is Peter here? The Lord told my master that he was here. And we need to take him back with us because God told my master that Peter got a message for us. He's going to tell us what we ought to do. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. My God, I felt that. Hallelujah. The preacher going to tell you what you ought to do. Hallelujah. You ain't got to do nothing, I say. Hallelujah. But if you want to be saved, you got to hear me and every other preacher that's preaching the truth of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible said, how can you hear without a preacher? And how can they preach except they be sent? How can you believe on whom you never heard? Thank you, Jesus. It's Peter here. Tell him to come on down here. He's being summoned to come to Cornelius' house, the Gentile. Hallelujah. Verse 17, now while Peter doubted himself what this meant, okay, they stood before the gate. Verse 19, while Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, who said it? The Spirit said unto him, behold, three men seek thee. While he up there thinking on his vision, God spoke to him and said, three men downstairs waiting on you. Right? Arise therefore and get thee down and go with them, doubting nothing. God told Peter, don't doubt nothing. You go with them. Hallelujah. For I have sent them. See, God said, I have sent them. Huh? Thank you, Jesus. Then Peter went down to the men which were sent unto him from Cornelius and said, behold, I am whom ye seek. I'm Peter. What you need? What is the cause whereof you are come? Why are you here? What are you doing all the way over here? Huh? Why did you travel from Caesarea all the way to Joppa to knock on the gate to find me? What do you want? And they said, Cornelius the centurion, a just man, a righteous man, and one that feareth God and of good report among all the nation of the Jews, was warned from God. Warned. See that word? He said he was warned from God by an holy angel to send for thee into his house and to hear words of thee. Now, when the angel went to Cornelius, when we read that part, it didn't sound like a warning, did it? Usually when you think about a warning, you think about, you know, somebody, you know, shouting to you saying, beware, behold, you know? The angels came to him, look, God has seen your good works. Now send some folk down to Peter and tell him, come on down, he got something he ought to tell you. See? Well, not with a preacher. Whenever a man of God open up his mouth and tell you something you ought to do, he is warning you. Warning you to escape the damnation that is to come. Hallelujah. And you can count yourself worthy enough to escape if you obey the words of the preacher. Hallelujah. Then called he them in, verse 23, and lodged them. And on the morrow, Peter went away with them. Peter said, come on in the house. We're going to leave in the morning. We'll make our way back to where you come from, to Caesarea. A certain brother from Joppa accompanied him. So as they made their way back the next day to Caesarea, to Cornelius' house, Peter brought some of his Jewish friends with him. Huh? Some of the Jews that was lodged at Simon's house with him, he said, come on, y'all come with me. I don't want to go down here by myself into these Gentiles' house. Huh? But what really God needed was them to come so that they could also be a witness of how God blessed the Gentiles with the same Holy Ghost that they received on Pentecost. My God, hallelujah. Huh? Thank you, Jesus. And the morrow after they entered into Caesarea, and Cornelius waited for them, and had called together his kinsmen and near friends. Cornelius, while he was on their way back, Cornelius had got his family members together, his near friends together, and got them all at the house, waiting on Peter and his servants to get back. Huh? Cornelius then gathered them together, so all of them could hear the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Gathered them together for an in-house Bible study. Hallelujah. And as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshiped him. What? Huh? Cornelius, you have lost your mind. You gonna fall down at the preacher? You gonna start worshiping the preacher? A false prophet would have said, "Yeah, stay down there. Give me my glory." Yeah. That's what a false prophet would have, huh? Yeah, worship me. Give me my glory. But Peter knew God would get all the glory. So look what Peter did. He fell down at Peter's feet and started to worship him. But Peter took him up, saying, "Stand up. I myself also am a man." I'm a man just like you. Stand up. You worship me or any other man. Verse 27. And as he talked with them, he went in and found many that were come together. My God. Hallelujah. I'm glad when people gather together to hear the word of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And he said unto them, ye know how that it is an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto one of another nation. Huh? See? They just weren't forbidden to, they just weren't commanded to stay away from meats, certain meats and four-footed beasts and fowls. They weren't just commanded them, but they was commanded to not even keep company with other nations unless they were Jews. Ain't that sad? Thank you, Jesus. So you see why God used the beast to represent the other nation that God wanted to come to? They were forbidden to go to eat or to go to either one of them. When God told him, rise, kill, and eat, that was God telling him, you need to go into this other nation and preach the word to them, because salvation has now come to the house of Cornelius. Hallelujah. Thank God for giving us a chance. You know, us Gentiles, if you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. I don't care where you're from or who you are. If you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. Huh? If you ain't got descendants from Israel, you're a Gentile. And God has come to the Gentiles. Hallelujah. Gave us a chance. Huh? Yeah. The only reason we got this chance is because the Jews kept disobeying God. Huh? God turned to us Gentiles so that he could provoke the Jews to jealousy. That's what it says in Romans chapter 11. Thank you, Jesus. So, he said, but God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. See, God told him don't call no beast common or unclean in the vision. See? In the vision, when God showed him the four-footed beast and the fowl, and it said, rise, get up and eat, kill and eat. Peter said, I ain't never ate nothing common or unclean. And God said, what I have cleansed, don't call common. Don't call it unclean if I've cleansed it. See? And now here's Peter. Peter now got revelation of what this vision was. And that's why now he said, God said, don't call any man unclean. See? Thank you, Jesus. Therefore came I unto you without gainsaying, as soon as I was sent for. I ask therefore, what intent ye have sent for me? Cornelius said, 4 days ago I was fasting until this hour. And at the ninth hour I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing, and said, Cornelius, thy prayer is heard, and thine alms are had in remembrance in the sight of God. Send therefore to Joppa, and call hither Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lost in the house of one Simon, a tanner of the seaside, who when he cometh shall speak unto thee. Immediately, therefore, I sent to thee. And thou hast well done that thou art come. Now therefore are we all here present before God, to hear all the things that are commanded thee of God. Come on, give me that word. My soul needs the word that God said you got for me. We all here, we gathered here, hallelujah, in this place, hallelujah. And we need a word, a rhema word, hallelujah, in this house today. Thank you, Jesus. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. Peter done got some revelation now. Hallelujah. He done realized, oh, this is what God meant by the vision. God is not a respecter of persons. Hallelujah. But if any man will come to God and repent, God will receive him. Hallelujah. If any man will come unto me, Jesus said, I will in no wise cast him out. Hallelujah. You got to understand that God ain't thrown you away. Hallelujah. God haven't given up on nobody. Hallelujah. God will forgive any sin that you've committed. Just don't blaspheme the Holy Ghost. Because the Bible said, hallelujah, that he won't forgive blasphemy of the Holy Ghost in this world nor the world to come. Hallelujah. So if you watch your mouth, hallelujah, and use that tone to praise God and repent of your sins, God will, hallelujah, save your soul and sanctify you and justify you in the name of the Lord and by the Spirit of our God. He ain't no respect of person. Now, he done went beyond Israel. Hallelujah. He done went into every nation. Hallelujah. And preached the gospel. Hallelujah. He commanded his disciples to go all over the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Hallelujah. Not just the Jewish nation, but every creature. Hallelujah. And he said, he, hallelujah, that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. And he that believeth not shall be damned. Hallelujah. You want to be saved, you got to, hallelujah, hear the word of God, believe the word of God, obey the word of God, hallelujah, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues, as the Spirit of God give you the utterance, and you repent of them sins and get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, according to Acts chapter 2 and verse 38, hallelujah, you be on your way to heaven, as long as you stay away from sin. Somebody give God a praise up in this place. Hallelujah. He said, but in every nation, hallelujah, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. Hallelujah. You fear God and work righteousness. You live in righteousness. You be righteous. Stay away from sin. The Bible said you are accepted of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That's one thing people got twisted. You got all these preachers. Hallelujah. Y'all see the word that the Bible said, if we, hallelujah, if we, thank you, Jesus, fear him and work righteousness. He said, we are accepted with him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's what people got twisted. All these preachers today looking on TV broadcasts and all over Facebook and social media, everywhere, in churches. They telling the people, oh, if you pray this prayer and you accept the Lord as your personal Savior, you don't need to be accepting the Lord. You need to be worried about whether he going to accept you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Y'all act like God up in heaven all week and begging and crying, wishing that we would accept him. Oh, I hope you accept me. Please accept me. No, God ain't no weak one. Hallelujah. If you, hallelujah, you need to do right and worry if he going to accept you or not. He's the one in control. You not in control. Hallelujah. So he's the one that does the accepting. You don't do no accepting. Hallelujah. You accept what his word say and obey the word. And the Bible say he will accept you. Hallelujah. But you can't accept the Lord as your personal Savior. He choose you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Y'all got the game twisted. Hallelujah. Like God up there crying and hoping and wishing. Hallelujah. That everybody all over the world would just accept the Lord as their personal Savior. Everybody, every place you read in the Bible, when you go from the Old Testament all the way over to the New Testament, you find that the people were concerned and worried about whether God was going to accept them. And God was not worried about whether they was going to accept him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, because God is the master. God is in control. Hallelujah. So we do what he's saying and hope he accept us. Hallelujah. And we find an encouraging scripture here this morning. It says that, hallelujah, if we fear him and work righteousness, we are accepted of him. He do the accepting, not us. So y'all got the game twisted. Hallelujah. Y'all are twisted up God's word. Hallelujah. And y'all need to untwist it and get it right. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The word was God sent unto the children of Israel, verse 36, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. Who's Lord of all? Jesus Christ. Who's Lord of all?
Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Jesus. So the Bible say they got baptized in the name of the Lord. What's the name of the Lord? Who's the Lord?
Jesus Christ.
According to verse 36, it's Jesus Christ, right? Yep. It say he is Lord of all. It say Jesus Christ is Lord of all. So when we get down here, down to verse 48, and it said they were baptized in the name of the Lord. Everybody look at verse 48. We'll come back up to 37. Look at 48. And he said, and he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. See? They didn't baptize themselves. I now baptize you in the name of the Lord. No. They used the Lord's name. They got baptized in the name of the Lord. They used the Lord's name. And in verse 36, it says, Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. They got baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. That's what all y'all need to do. Preachers got that twisted too, huh? They got it twisted. They need to untwist it and keep it straight. Hallelujah. And don't get it twisted no more. Thank you, Jesus. All these preachers baptizing folk in titles, Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Ain't no place in the Bible where anybody did that. The only baptism that the apostles performed in the New Testament was in the name of Jesus Christ. That's how it got to be done. In the name of Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. When you say he's Lord, you're saying he's God. Huh? Because the Bible said, the Lord, he is God. Hallelujah. Y'all better read your Bibles. Hallelujah. And in Deuteronomy, it said, the Lord thy God. See? The Bible calls the Lord God. So when you say Jesus is Lord, you're saying Jesus is the Lord God. Hallelujah. But people don't believe that. Oh no, he's just the Son of God. No, he's more than that. You're calling your Bible a lie. Look at the Bible. Read the Bible. It said Jesus Christ is Lord of all. And then it also said in Philippians that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue must confess that he is Lord. Hallelujah. Folk need to get it right, keep it straight, and don't get it twisted. Hallelujah. Verse 37. That word I say, ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Hallelujah. For God was with him. And we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, who they slew and hanged on a tree. This means they hung him on a cross. They hung him on that wood, the tree. Him God raised up the third day and showed him openly, not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before of God, even to us who didn't eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. See, after Jesus Christ rose, let's show you right there, he's God. After he rose from the dead, he was walking around showing himself alive, eating and drinking with folk. Huh? Won't no blood in his body. He was walking around with them holes in his hands, that hole in his side and in his feet. No pain in his body. Won't bleed. It won't no blood in the body. Because he had to pour it all out for us and pick that body back up after all the blood was gone out of it. 3 days and three nights he was in the grave. And 3 days and after 3 days and three nights, he rose again in that same body, walking around. Holes, no pain, no blood, but eating fish. Huh?
Wow.
Eating and drinking. That's what Peter said. Peter said, I saw this with my own eyes. Huh? Peter ain't telling something that he read in a book or heard about. He said he was eating with me. He showed himself alive to me after he rose from the dead. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us. He commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be the judge of the quick and the dead, huh? It said Jesus was going to be the judge, right? Huh? That's what it means by Jesus sat on the right hand of the throne, or the right hand of God. He sat out on the right hand of power. Huh? He's the judge. It ain't saying God on the throne and Jesus sitting on the right hand of the throne beside God. No, Jesus is God. He sat down on the right hand of power. The right hand of majesty. When you read Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 1, it says Jesus sat down on the right hand of majesty. See? Majesty means power. So he's judged. He's going to judge the quick and the dead. He's going to judge the living and the dead. See? But at the moment, there's a door of grace. So God said, look, I'm not judged right now. I'm sitting that judgment power aside. I'm going to give y'all time to get yourselves together. But I'm going to put that power back up. And when I sit back on my throne, I'll be judged again. And I'm going to judge everybody according to their works, whether they be good or bad. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Ain't no three in heaven. There's only one, and that's Jesus Christ. Huh? There's one, Jesus Christ. The flesh of God is not in heaven. See? Thank you, Jesus. It's the Spirit. He said in verse 43, to him give all the prophets witness that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. Now, he didn't say if you believe in him, you have the remission of sins. He said you shall receive it. See? You will receive it. How will you receive it? After you obey the rest of his word. Because if you believe on his name, if you believe in Jesus, you're going to obey Jesus to get the remission of sins. Now, when we rightly divide the word of truth and we read Acts chapter 2 and verse 38, it tells us how to receive the remission of sins. And it says, repent. That means to turn from sin. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for something. For the remission of sin. That's how you get. If you believe in his name, you'll repent of your sins and get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for. For, F-O-R, for the remission of sins. See? And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. How do you get the remission of sins? You first turn from the sin. Then you get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Now all you preachers that don't believe in that, and all you members and deacons and ministers that don't believe that, you go through Acts chapter 2 verse 38 and try to tear that apart. How can you make that out of what is not? How can you turn it into something that ain't? A lot of preachers preach, oh, if you get baptized, they're going to wash away sin. Well, the Bible says it's for the remission of sins. How do you explain that away? Huh? I want to see you make a fool of yourself. Try to explain that away. Just take the Bible for what it is and believe it. For the baptism in Jesus' name and the repentance of sins is for the remission of sins, the remission, the remitting, the taking away, translation, the forgiveness. That's what remission means, to remit, to take away, forgiveness. Those are definitions of remission. Now, how do you explain it away? There's a preacher on the radio up here in Louisville, Kentucky. Every time he get on the radio, that's the only thing he talk about. He was brought up and taught this apostolic doctrine. At one time, he believed this apostolic doctrine. He used to believe that the only way to heaven was through repentance, the baptism in Jesus' name for the remission of sins, and being filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance. He believed that. But now he had been brainwashed by the devil, and the devil had made him a false prophet. He had lured him and persuaded him into taking off of that doctrine, and now he preaches something against the apostles' doctrine. And every time he's on the radio, he's telling people, oh, that ain't what the baptism was for. If the baptism was for that, then why do people keep on sinning? No, you keep on sinning because you ain't got the Holy Ghost. That's what's going on. Go judge everybody else's life all because you can't live right because you've been persuaded to be lured away from God. Look, y'all, we've come too far to turn around now. Don't let the devil lure you away from God. Stick with God. Stay in God. Grow in faith and in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. We was just talking about these false prophets last week. How they come in sheep's clothing, huh? But inwardly they're raping and wolves. Don't let no wolf pull you out of the church. Don't let no wolf devour you. Stand against the wolf, huh? You see the wolf? Cry wolf. Hallelujah. Huh? That's what I'm doing. I'm going to cry. Cry. Wolf, wolf. Huh? I see a little tail winging behind you. Huh? Your teeth don't look like sheep teeth. It don't look like the teeth of a flock. You smell like a wolf to me. Huh? You look like a wolf to me. You might can fool the members, but you can't fool the house. Hallelujah. The ruler of the house. Hallelujah. Huh? Thank you, Jesus. He said, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. You will receive the remission of sins if you believe in Jesus. If, one of the biggest words in the Bible is if. It's conditional. If you obey the rest of his word. In verse 44 it says, while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word. While he was yet talking, y'all, ain't that something? The Holy Ghost didn't wait till they got around the altar and held hands and anointed them with oil. While he was yet preaching, he said, while he yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them which heard it. They believed the word so much they repented right there in their seats, and the Holy Ghost fell on them right then. And they of the circumcision, those of the circumcision, that's the Jews, those Jewish people that Peter brought with him, they of the circumcision which believed were astonished. They were shocked, surprised, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. How did they know they had the Holy Ghost? For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. When you get the Holy Ghost, you're going to speak in tongues. Hallelujah. This ain't French. It ain't Spanish. It ain't English. Huh? It ain't hola, como esta? Huh? It ain't German. Huh? Jimmy Bad Pepper. I know I messed that up.
Yeah, you did.
Huh? It ain't nothing you can understand. Or anybody else can understand. It is a language from God. It is the Spirit praying for your spirit. Hallelujah. With moanings that cannot be uttered. Hallelujah. For they heard, verse 46, for they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? Look, when we started this thing off in Acts 10, sounded like Cornelius was an alright man, right? Sounded like he was saved, sanctified, Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized. That sounded like he had Jesus on his side. Sound like he was running for his life. Huh? Yeah. Singing songs of Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Huh? Sing the praises to God. Praying to God. Fear God. Look, he even told his family to fear God. Devout man. Good man. Huh? He had a good name amongst the Gentiles and the Jews. But he didn't have the Holy Ghost. And if he wouldn't have got the Holy Ghost, guess what? Cornelius, with all his good deeds, would have went straight to hell. You better make sure you got it. Make sure your calling and election is sure. Huh? Make sure. This ain't nothing to play Russian roulette with, y'all. This ain't nothing to tiptoe around. You need to get it right in the sight of God. Don't let the devil trick you into thinking because you're going to church every time the door's open and because you're praying, huh, all the time and crying to Jesus and feeling good in his presence, that don't mean you're saved. You need to make sure you got the Holy Ghost. Better make sure you've been baptized the right way in the name of Jesus Christ. If the preacher said, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, when he baptized you and dunked you on the water, you was baptized wrong, and you need to go back to the water and have it done in the name of Jesus. Don't let no false prophet take you to hell. People do a whole lot better coming to church rather than being the church. They find it more easier to come to church rather than to be the church. Don't just come here. Be the church outside of here. Hallelujah. Still got to come. The Bible said, forsake not the assembling of yourselves as you see the day approaching. God wants us to gather. He wants us to gather together and get Jesus. Especially in these last days. He said, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We'll read verse 36. It said, Jesus, he is Lord of all. That is the name of the Lord, Jesus. Then prayed they him to tarry certain days. People of God, people of all nations, you got some examining to do within yourself. The Bible said this in 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. The Bible said, examine yourselves whether you be in the faith, lest ye be reprobates. Examine yourself. Hallelujah. Make sure you got it right. May God bless you. May heaven smile upon you in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody give God a praise for the word today.